Good morning, everyone. Welcome back. Pointers today. Before reviewing it, something that we covered in the previous leg, size off, what is going to be the output of this program? Do we understand this program 100%? The line number one, size off. You can put here the name of a variable. That is something that we did before. Also, it is possible to put the name of a type, but the name of a type between parentheses. With that, you can get the size of any variable that is that type. So in this scenario, I am asking for the size of the integer data type, for the size of anything that is integer. Obviously, the second line is asking for the size of a variable x, but x is integer, so hopefully the result of these two are going to be the same. The size of x is going to be the same size that any other integer, or the size of the integer in general. Size of, you can use with an array, and hopefully you remember what is going to be the size of this guy here, that is integer and have 5 elements. According with the chat, maybe the first one is 4, maybe the second one is 4, maybe the next one is going to be 20. What do you think about the size of array position 0? We can do that. So the size of the element in the position 0 is one element in the array, right? And it's integer. Should be 4, assuming that all the integers are 4. Size of parentheses, the name of the type. But I am asking for the size of the data type. So size of char is going to be 1, right? Or 2. 2 in Java, 1 in C. Don't forget. Now, size of x, this one should be c because we already did x. So c is a char, it should be also 1. And what about the size of the element 0 in an array of chars? Hopefully also 1. Makes sense. These are the kind of questions that maybe you are going to have in your exam. Most of the exam is going to be multiple choice. Your exams are going to be online. So a picture of a source code and maybe a question about what is happening in a particular line or what is happening in the source code. So in this case, maybe this one, something like that could be an answer for an open question in your exam. Okay, so seems that this is clear. Pointers. For the pointers, let's check. Important things that you need to remember and have in your mind while we're working with this. Number one, variables. Variables are spaces in the memory. Every single time that we talk about a variable, you need to remember that you have your RAM memory, and every single byte in the RAM, every one of these spaces, that space have an address. You can think about every single one of these small blocks have a number. I can access to the block 1, 2, 3, to the byte 1, 2, 3, and so on. The computer, the CPU, the hardware, do not work with this idea of this here being the variable y. that do not make sense for the computer. The computer know that you want to do something here because that one is the element number 6 in your memory. And your memory is huge. You have this kind of structure with megabytes, gigabytes, whatever. Every single variable, like this Y, every single time that you create an integer, a character, obviously an array, all of them, each of the elements have an address. This is the address, the index, the position in the memory, right? Something that I am going to do, and usually you are going to find in computer science, is when we talk about the addresses, when we talk about these numbers that represent the position in the memory, we're going to use hexadecimal numbers. Hexadecimal numbers, yeah, this notation about 0x something. Why? Just to differentiate them from the value that we put inside of the variable. Again, not because it's different in the computer. Use when we are talking, when you view the picture for you, for me, when we read this number, the hexadecimal one, we know that we're talking about the address, maybe the index of this particular position, just because it's an hexadecimal number, just because we are going to use hexadecimals for the memory. And when we read a decimal number, we can agree that we're talking about values. So that is the only reason. But again, the address is a number, just a number. We're going to have variables, and I am going to use this box here. That one, my variable x, is an integer. I am not going to draw the 4 bytes. Remember, the integer is really this idea of 4 bytes. So the box should be something like the box, but well, inside I have these 4 bytes, and I am storing a 5. Well, really the 5 is this 1010 and all the rest in zeros. We're not going to work in that level of detail. Instead of this, I am going to put you the box, and the blue box is going to represent a space of 4 bytes, just because you know that integer is 4 bytes. And instead of representing the 5 in binary, which do not make sense, we are not going to work with binary, let's just put inside of the box the 5, and you know that 5 is stored as a binary number in the hardware. But this is going to be my variable x, and I am going to put the name there, just to remember that that one is the variable. But now I am going to start adding this, the address of the variable, which is going to be the address of a variable when you create some variable in a program. We do not really know. The operating system is the one that is going to put your variable in some place, some random place. So what I am going to do in my examples is, well, if I create a variable x, that variable x have an address because it's in some place in the memory. And randomly, I am going to put a number there. So that variable is in the address, in the position 0x, hexadecimal, and D4, hexadecimal number. Why in the D4? Why not? Just to put an address there. So if I ask you which is the address of x, well, you can agree with me is 0xD4. That is the address. But again, a random address in the memory. We as a developers, we do not control the address of the specific address of our variables. That is something that the operating system do. Anyway, anytime that you create a variable, primitive or not, your variable has an address. All the variables are in one place in the memory. All the variables have an address. Now, something that we can do in C we can work with addresses. The first thing that we learned previously is, well, if you have that variable X, you can do a print F and you can print as a decimal number the variable X. This instruction in C, print on the screen the number 5. Now, something that we reviewed before, not in detail, but I mentioned this. Also, you can use printf. And now we can use P here. We're going to be working with this P. And if I want to print P, P is a pointer. P represents an address. Do you remember what we do in order to get the address of a variable in a program? For instance, what we do if I want to get the address for my variable X? There is any way that I can get the address of X? Yes. We use this for the scanf. In the scanf, because the scanf needs the address in order to store the new information in that address. You can use an ampersand in any place that you want. For instance, you can use that one here to ask for the address of X, and then because it's an address, you can print that using the percentage P. And you know what? You are going to have with this print on the screen in this example that number, this number. You as a developer have access to know exactly in which position of the memory is your variable. And again, you can run this program, and obviously in your computer, it's not going to be 0xd4, it's going to be a little bit longer, the number. And for every single one of you, or if you run the same program, this print, in different computers, the same computer several times in your computer, run and then run again. Every single time that you run the program, probably this number is going to be different. Why? Because the operating system is not giving you, is not storing the variable in the same position every single time. Think about the probabilities. How many blocks, spaces, bytes do you have in the RAM, and the probability that two times the variable go to the same place? Well, not in the program running outside of your developer environment. So, yeah, this address in runtime is assigned. But you can print the address. So notice the difference between both. You can print the value, you can print the address, and the name. The name is something that only you know, only the program knows, because the name is something for the program. The name is like this nickname for the address, because the computer is going to work every single thing using this address. When you compile the program in the source code, in the machine language, X do not exist. What you have in every single instruction there is this thing. Anyway, you can print it. Now, pointers. You know what? What happened if I want a variable? A variable, a space in the memory to store information. But the information that I want to store is not a value like here. This is a variable, and the information that I store in the variable is a value, the number 5. You know what? I would like to have a variable to store an address. For instance, I know that with ampersand X, this is the address of the variable X. It's an address. And I would like to store that address in some place, in a variable. But this variable is a very special variable. It's a variable that is going to store an address of something. not a value, but an address. The address of another variable, maybe. That is the definition of a pointer. This guy, because he's going to store the address of something, that guy is pointing to that something. In order to store the variable of something, let me tell you this. The address of an integer is different from the address of a char, and is different from the address of a double or any other data type. Why? Because the address is the address of the first element, but the integer is 4 bytes starting in that element. The char is 1 byte starting in this element. So the type is important. If I want to store the address of an integer, I will need this special variable to store the address of an integer that we're going to call a pointer to an integer. And in order to create a pointer, what I need is the data type, the name, and one asterisk. Data type, asterisk, name. With this notation, you create a pointer. With this notation, you create a variable that is going to store not an integer value, but the address of an integer. In this case, with this notation, you can create a variable that stores the address of the integer X. Now, obviously, variable for a value, pointer. How do you know that it's a pointer? Because this asterisk here. When you put the asterisk between the type and the name of a variable, what you are doing is creating a pointer. It's not multiplication. No, because it's not a binary operator. You are not doing the multiplication of the type and the name. It's the symbol that we use to create a pointer. A pointer, this small box that is going to be called Y, but inside is going to be able to store addresses like this one, that is the address of this one. Now, something that is important to remember, the green box is also a variable. It's a pointer because it stores the address of someone else, but it's a variable. Therefore, this one has also its own address. Going back here to my RAM memory, I have here a variable that have a file, and I have here another variable that is storing this address, but this one have its own address depending on the place that is in the memory. This one is called a pointer just because if I have the address, the idea is that I am pointing to the other. That is the reason because we call it a pointer. I have the address, that means I know where the other variable is. Makes sense. So, definition of a pointer, a variable that stores addresses, and how to create a pointer using the asterisk after the data type. You are going to have pointers for every single data type that you use to store information. Now, at this point, I have introduced to you the two operators that we're going to be using with pointers. Number one, ampersand. The ampersand is going to give me the address if I give the name of the variable. I give the name of the variable and the ampersand give me the address. The asterisk is going to have two responsibilities. The first one is I am going to use the asterisk in order to create variables that store addresses, adding the asterisk between the type and the name of the variable. So far, so good. But also, it's going to have a second responsibility. And maybe you can help me to guess what is that responsibility with this source code. Let's see. Number one, if you check the source code, you have our library. The library that we use in order to get access to printf. That is easy. I have a main. In this case, the main that return an integer. I am returning an integer. Everything is fine. Then I have two variables. The same that I have before with the file. The same that I have before this one. That one is a pointer. I know that it's a pointer because the asterisk. So the pointer and the variable with the value. Here, I am storing the address in the variable. Notice, I can use this in two lines, or you can do only one line. It doesn't matter. In the example, two lines, you can get used to it in one line. The asterisk for creating the variable, the ampersand for getting the address, and the result that you get after you run this line is this. That is what you have in the memory. Two variables, we do not know where they are, but each of them have an address, each of them have a name in the program, and one have inside the file, and the other have inside the address of something else, the address that you get with the ampersand. So far, so good. Now, let's use the printf again, like we did before. Number one, if I print the x, I want to print the x, I am going to use a percentage d. Percentage d and the x. And at this point, I am sure that you're going to agree with me that is the output. I am going to print the 5 because it's what you have inside of the variable. That was easy. Now, I can use also ampersand x. Ampersand x, ampersand is the operator that I use to get the address. If I want to print that, I am going to use percentage p. And hopefully you have the opportunity to review this. The only thing that percentage p is going to do is to print the information as an hexadecimal number. And in your computer, well, in a laptop, or maybe in the online compiler, you're going to have on the screen something like this. The address of my variable is all these big numbers. Because remember, you're talking about megabytes, gigabytes of memory, so obviously you need a long number for the addresses. Something like this. I am going to use small numbers for my examples. You do not want to see this there. So the address. This is the address of X. So far, good. Now, I can print Y. Notice, for Y, I am not using here the asterisk. This Y is like the X before. And obviously, I am going to use the percentage P because I want the output as an hexadecimal number. But notice, no ampersand here. Why? Well, without anything, I am printing what is inside of the variable. So I print here the 5. With this line here, I want to print what is inside of the variable. And what is inside, it should be the same address of ampersand x. Hopefully you notice these two are the same. The value that I get with ampersand x and with y, they are the same. One is getting the address with the operator. The other is the value inside of the variable, the pointer. And they are the same and make sense because, well, we did this assignation, right? They should be the same. What happened if I use the ampersand for the Y? I am asking for the address of Y. Excuse me. Hopefully you agree with me. With the ampersand Y, I am asking for this number, the address of that variable. Obviously, I want to print with percentage P. I want to print in hexadecimal. But now is I am asking for the address, not the one that is stored inside. I am asking for the address of that particular block, the green block. If you check the last number, they are not the same. So the number that is stored inside and the number that is here, a little bit different. So like D4, but the address of this variable, D8, whatever. The address of the variable and the address that the variable store inside. Now, the most important thing here. The second thing that the asterisk can do is this example. The asterisk represents this arrow here. Remember, one thing, the asterisk is for the declaration of the pointer. That was one thing. Second thing, the asterisk represents the arrow. Why? Because hopefully you notice here, I want to print a decimal value. I am asking for a decimal value and I am printing asterisk Y. Asterisk Y on what I am going to have in the file. What is the meaning of that? Well, the meaning of that is Y is this green box. And when I put the asterisk here, I am asking the computer, for this variable, go to the address that you have there. Go here and take the value that is inside the file, print the file. The ampersand give you the address of any variable. The asterisk is the instruction that you have to ask the computer, go to this address and access the data inside of that address. Asterisk, give me the address. Ampersand, give me the address. Asterisk, give me the data. W, 100. Double, asterisk, P, equal. W is a variable, the variable have inside 100. P should be a pointer, and I want this pointer pointing there. Question in your exam, what do I need to put here in order to accomplish the goal in the picture? Correct. Okay, good question. What happens if you use percentage D here? What happens if inside of percentage P you put a percentage D? What is going to happen? Nothing. You are going to have this number printed in decimal instead of in hexadecimal. Remember, the only thing that this change is the format. So percentage D is to print things in decimal format, decimal numbers, base 10. Percentage P used to make them fancy 0x something. If you put percentage D, you're going to have a decimal value and a really big decimal value. So this one, ampersand W, and the ampersand W, because makes sense, the address, whatever is here, is whatever is here. Done. The important thing is, if I want to do something like, you know what? W equal 5. Do we understand what is going to happen if we do W equal 5, right? Goodbye to the 100. And now the 5 is going to be there. That is normal. The good news now is, what if I told you that I can put a value in a variable, but I do not need the variable? Asterisk P equal 20. The first mistake that you can make here is thinking that the 20 is going to be stored here. But that is not the case, because I am not doing P equal 20. That is not the instruction. The instruction is asterisk P equal 20. And who is asterisk P? Well, go to P, the address, and the asterisk represent this arrow, the jump. So this is asterisk P. Asterisk P is W. And when I ask for the number 20 to be stored in asterisk P, what is going to happen is I am going to have the number 20 here. I can change the value inside of what is supposed to be my variable W without using the name W. Pointers give you access to any place in the memory, and you do not need the names. You do not need to create the variable. You have the address, you use the asterisk, you can put whatever you want there. Make sense? So far, so good? So obviously, if I can use this to change the value, well, I think my example is too simple now. I can use this in the same way that I use this, used to print the 5. Asterisk Y is the same that X, because Y and the asterisk ends here, and this is X. Can you imagine the consequences of this? Because all of that thing that you learn about global variables and local variables, in particular, local variables can only be used inside of the method that have the variables. Well, things are going to change. Moreover, can you imagine the consequences of doing something wrong with this? Having access, unlimited access to any of my spaces here used with the number that represent the address. We're going to do interesting things. Anyway, so this one was easy, just printing things. Now, what do you think about this example? Okay, this X look like a variable, and it have an address. Okay, but it looks like you are storing the address of this variable in this green box. This one should be a pointer, right? Because it's a variable that is storing the address of something. Okay, your pointer is going to be, is going to have a name. Why? And the pointer also have an address, right? What if I want to store that address, this one, the address of the pointer, inside of another variable? Well, I think I can do that, right? This one, store here. Now, this one is not a pointer, because this one is pointing to a pointer. This one is a pointer, because this one is pointing to a value. Pointers point to a value. This one is pointing to a pointer, and the pointer point to a value. Did you notice? It's like asterisk here, kind of, again, the asterisk represents the arrow. And what if I told you that these three lines are the ones that create the picture? Variable X with the value 5 inside my blue box. Variable Y is a pointer, the asterisk. And it's going to store the address of X, the address of X, 0x8, inside of Y, 0xA, the pointer Y pointing to the variable X. So far, so good. C, a pointer to a pointer. Okay, a pointer to a pointer. Two asterisks. A pointer to a pointer. A pointer to a pointer. What can I store in a variable that is a pointer to a pointer? The address of a pointer. Now, here, a lot of consequences. Reading the chat. What is the benefit of using the address instead of the name? Don't worry, we're going to talk about that. Right now, I am showing you the notation. Why this is useful? We're going to review that. You're going to learn about it. But right now, what I can tell you is this is one of the most powerful tools that you have in programming. This is one of the things in programming that give you access to every single resource in your computer. Pointers. Anyway, we're going to review things and figure out why this is important. Anyway, now, what could happen, and you are giving me ideas, like what could happen if I have a pointer, whatever, and that pointer whatever is equal to the address of whatever. Here, the address of Y. In my example, the address of Y is a pointer. And when I get the address of a pointer, what I am receiving is a pointer to a pointer. The address of Y, because Y is a pointer, his address is a pointer to pointer. So address of Y, I need to think about two asterisks. And what happens if I have a variable here that is only one asterisk? Good news, this is going to be a compilation error. A compilation error, semantic. Semantic, why? The types do not match. You are trying to store a pointer to pointer in a variable that is used as a single pointer. Okay, before, we need to think about integers versus floats and chars versus integers and things like that. Now, we need to think about, well, this is a value, this is a pointer, or this is a pointer to pointer, or maybe a pointer to pointer to pointer. This error is the same error that you're going to receive if you try to do something like int x equal to the address of x. It doesn't matter the name of the variable, but again, if you try to store the address of the variable inside of the variable, this, the address of the variable is a pointer. And this is just an integer. So one asterisk, no asterisk. this is going to be also a compilation error, semantic error, type do not match. Anyway, what do you think about a variable in order to have the value 5 here, some variable pointing there, and another variable pointing there, and another variable pointing there? Can you give me the source code for something like this in C with pointers? I can give you the first one. Hopefully you agree with me, B, C, and D, all of them are going to be integers. I mean, we're working with integers, right? By the way, if you create a pointer to double and you try to point to an integer, it's going to be also an error, type do not match. So anything that do not match types is going to be reported by the compiler. Here, integers, do I need something else for B or for C or for D? Well, hopefully you agree with me, B is a pointer. So an asterisk there could be a good idea. Well, what about C? Well, C is a pointer, but it's pointing to something that is a pointer. So probably C is going to need two asterisks. What about D? Well, it's also a pointer, but it's pointing to something that is a pointer to pointer. Did you get the idea? Can I do this forever? Do you remember your arrays? Unidimensional arrays, two-dimensional arrays, three-dimensional arrays. Can I continue forever? Yes, yes. Yeah, obviously, theoretically, because one thing is what we can do on paper, and the other thing is what the computer can handle. But theoretically, yes, you can continue forever. Obviously, with arrays, you work with three-dimensional arrays because that is easy to understand. Thinking about four-dimensional arrays is a little bit harder. You 3D with the time. But more than four is like, what is this? You do not do five-dimensional arrays or six-dimensional arrays. Usually the same is going to happen with pointers. Pointers are useful. Pointers to pointers, you are going to have them. These two are going to be maybe 90% of the time that you use pointers. More than two is not so common. No, it's not recursive. Recursion is something that is connected with actions and with calling methods. But if you think about the idea of something that is being repeated, yeah, it's kind of this idea like here or like here. But again, here, usually you stop with four. Here, usually you are going to stop with two, pointers to pointers. But I want to be clear, theoretically, you can continue forever. Use add more asterisk, and you can continue with these connections. Anyway, the important thing here is, if I want to print f, the value in decimal, I want to print this number 5 there. How many options do I have to print that number 5? Obviously, the first option is print the value for the variable, right? That is option one, the easy one. Another one, you can print, oh, the B asterisk B is, if I know the address B, I can use the asterisk, and that is jump from B to A. There is any way that I can print the number 5 using C? There is any way that I can print the number 5 using D? Several asterisks to create a pointer. Several asterisks to access the value inside of a particular position. This asterisk D is going to jump to C. Asterisk C is going to jump to B. Asterisk B is going to jump to A. Three asterisk D is the jump to A directly. Asterisk for defining the pointers, also asterisk in order to access the data inside of, well, each asterisk corresponds to a jump to a new address. Good? Having my program, hopefully you agree with me, all of these printings, X, the address of X, Y, the address of Y, the value inside of Y, C, the address of C, the value inside asterisk C, and moreover, the value inside asterisk asterisk C. Question in your exam, this source code, which is the output? The values of the things that I put in the red circles. You can answer that, right? I mean, here you have these strings in blue, but in the exam, I am going to remove the blue text. Use the values. Value for X. Can you agree with me this one is going to be 5? Ampersand X, Y, ampersand Y, asterisk C, and so on. Makes sense, that output? 5, the value of the variable, the address of the variable. The address of the variable is the same that the value inside of the pointer. The address of the pointer. Asterisk the pointer. And the same with C. Now, be careful. If you use only one time asterisk C, or if you use two asterisk C, hopefully you agree with me, asterisk asterisk C is going to print 5, C, asterisk, asterisk, 2 jumps. If I ask for 1 asterisk C, it's going to print the value inside of Y. Why the value inside of Y? Well, because the value inside of Y, that by the way is the address of X, is C, with 1 asterisk. 1 asterisk with a pointer to pointer give you access to the value in the next pointer that I am pointing. And this is going to become crazy. And yes, if you do asterisk asterisk C equal 100, for instance, where is going to be stored the 100? So you're telling me that I can use the pointer, Y, to change the value in X. Moreover, you are telling me that I can use a pointer to the pointer to change the value in a variable to which I didn't even know the address. Yeah. The only thing that you need is a connection, several pointing things, several arrows in somehow you can find a path that connects you with that specific position. The only thing that you need is the correct number of asterisks that allow you to access the place. And in this case, asterisk, asterisk, C is exactly the same that using X. Whatever thing you put here is going to be stored in X. Use like that, pointers. Good. And obviously, one asterisk C is the equivalent to use Y. For instance, you can do Y is equal to the address of X, but also it's true that the asterisk C is equal to the address of X. Again, you cannot do that. Very good question in the chat. It's like, hey, what happened if I do something like int asterisk X equal the ampersand Y? What happened if I do int asterisk Y equal to the ampersand X? Problems with this. Number one, you cannot use Y if Y had not been initialized before, right? So in order to do this, I will need to have the Y above. So that means at least having something like this. And then I remove this thing here and I can just do the equal here. So, but if I try to do this, I have a problem, because when I try to do that, the compiler is going to tell me, well, what you are trying to do is this one is a pointer. Good. But this one is also a pointer. So you are trying to store in a pointer the address of a pointer. And in order to store the address of a pointer, you need a pointer to pointer. So this line is going to give you a compilation error, semantic error, types do not match. You cannot store the address of an address inside of something that only stores the address of a value. Error here. Therefore, you cannot continue with the next line. Never, 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 you can have two variables. And if this one stores the address of this one, it's because this one is a pointer and this one is a value. And a value cannot be a pointer. So it is not possible to have the connection back. And the same idea, if you have another box here, you can make this box to point here if this one is a pointer. But if you want this one to point here, this one should be a pointer to pointer. You cannot have both. If this one is pointer to pointer, it's going to be able to point here. If this one is just a single pointer, it's going to be able to point there, but not both. The number of asterisks, when you create the variables, they are important. Semantic errors, at least the compiler is going to be checking that. So you do not need to worry about having pointers or pointers to pointers. You're going to have other things to worry. Good. So in that case, in the chat, is an error, a semantic error. Good. Now, moving forward, this looks like easy. Another one. What could happen here? And I need to introduce a new concept. You can create pointers and variables in the same line. For instance, if I put integer here, I can create a variable and then I can create pointers. Notice that I can use the asterisk here to tell the computer, hey, B is going to be the pointer, but A is not a pointer. So instead of int asterisk and the name, well, int the names for variables, and I put the asterisk together with the name of whatever I want to be a pointer. In this case, B can be a pointer. And also in the same line, I can create pointers to pointers and I can put the two asterisks together with the name. So that one, the asterisks are not part of the name. The asterisks are going to be the definition. This one is integer asterisk asterisk. This one is integer asterisk. This one is use an integer. So I have A, B, C, just like before. My goal is going to be connecting them. Now, something that you can do with pointers, doesn't matter one or more asterisk, you can initialize them with zero. Now, with pointers, the value zero represent nil, null if you want. Nil, null, is that pointer is not pointing to any place. It's more like the minus one value if you think about it, because even though we are using zero, something that I want you to have clear is these guys, B and C, are not pointing to the first byte in your memory. Because the first byte is the byte in the position zero, right? It's an array. They are not pointing to zero. But we use zero as the value for this unknown place. When a pointer is equal to zero, the meaning is, okay, that pointer is not pointing to any place. And we use this notation from electronic things. That pointer is just nothing, empty, nil, null. That is the meaning when you saw the zero. You cannot point directly to the byte zero. We are not doing that, not in this line. Now, if you print the values, you can print obviously in one line everything, and even you can add an enter. If you notice, I am printing the first one as a value. I want to use the decimal format, and the others as a pointers, as an addresses. So I want to use this formatting in hexadecimal with a particular number of characters. A, B, and C, use the names. Then I can play with them. And for your exam, these kind of questions are going to be very, very common. What is happening there in those four instructions? What is happening there when I am doing B equal to the address of A, C equal to the address of B? And hopefully these two are clear. Then, well, it's just we are doing the connections. We're doing the connections, and when you run these two here inside, goodbye to the nil, goodbye to the zero. I am going to have the address of A here, and here I am going to have the address of B. That is what is going to happen, right? What is going to happen with those two? What is going to be the final value that is going to be printed here? And the question in your exam, literally, is going to be, what is printed by that line on the screen, open question, you have a box, and you write the output of this particular line in the program. Can you guess what is going to be printed by that line? In the chat, this idea of the layers, yeah, it's a good analogy, something like that. And that is a question in the chat. Could you agree with that? I am printing A. Can you agree that the last value in A is 48? And I think so, right? Because asterisk B is like A, and asterisk C, this instruction is storing the 48 in asterisk C, which is A. So I agree with this one. Now, B is a pointer, and I want to print whatever is the information inside of B, and C is a pointer, and I want to print whatever is the information inside of C. So if I review that, what I am going to print, I am going to print 44 or 48. I am going to print 48 or 98. There is any difference? What do I need to use if I want to print 44? The thing inside of B. Print B, print asterisk B, or print ampersand B. Which one, in this case, print the 40, the 0x44? A, B, or C for printing 0x44. If you want to print what is inside of the variable, B. What if I want to print 12, but using B? A, B, or C, which one is going to print 12? Correct. Asterisk B. Okay, what is going to be printed if I print ampersand B? What is the ampersand for? The address of the variable, in this example, 48. Ampersand B, 0x48, asterisk B, 12, just B, 0x44. Hopefully the difference is clear. Good news, pointers only have these two operators, the ampersand and the asterisk. Bad news, for some reason, crazy reason, the asterisk is multiplication as a binary operator, and then as unary operator is for pointers. But then for pointers, if you use the asterisk with a data type, is to declare the pointer. But if you use the asterisk in the instructions, is to access a value in a particular address. When you use the asterisk in the instructions, the asterisk is kind of the opposite of the ampersand. The ampersand gives you the address, the asterisk gives you the value. Ampersand B, the address of B, asterisk B, the value pointed by B. And B alone, the address that the store B. B, the pointer, the address. And the same apply for several uses of the asterisk, and therefore pointers to pointers, and so on. Anyway, another easy example. The first time you're going to have nil, that is what the computer print for the zero. Again, like the null in Java, here nil is the name. And for the other, well, if I run the program in my computer, I am going to have something like this. Again, the 48, the address stored here, and the address stored here. You can test the program, and well, it's going to be different values according with where your variables go. Moving forward, what do you think is going to happen with something like this? Could you agree with my statement? So are you telling me that if I have a variable A and that one have a 5 inside and this one have an address F, and then I have another variable that could be asterisk B, and if I make this equal to the address of A, I am going to store here this address, and therefore this one is going to be pointing there, and this one have another address. Notice that the addresses are not related. I mean, I can have this one in a position 100, and this one can be in a position 1. The second one do not need to be in an address that is bigger than the previous one. that is going to happen only with arrays, but with variables, random variables, the position can be in any place. The first variable can be down and the second variable can be in a position that is close to zero. So in these examples, are you telling me that, well, B asterisk equal to 10, according with this, this 10 is going to go here just because asterisk B is exactly the same that using A. So we know that ampersand A is what we used before to get 0xf. So making a combination of these two, are you telling me that the address of the asterisk of B in this case is equal to I have B. B is 0xf. Asterisk? Oh, that means go here. Wait, give me the address of this. Is this. 0xf is exactly the same that you have inside of the variable. These two together, like a plus and the minus, like multiplication and division, is used. What you originally have in the pointer. Make sense? Now, I like the question in the chat. It's like, and what about it's the same? Because plus and minus, the order is not important. What about the asterisk and the ampersand? What is asterisk the ampersand B? B, an ampersand, well, the ampersand B is going to be this 0xA, that is the address there, right? And what is asterisk there? Do we have a problem? Well, asterisk there should be something like and where is pointing? Well, the issue here is it's not really a pointer, but this one is going to give you the value inside of this address. And well, the value inside of that address is the value inside of B. Okay, you get the idea. Conclusion here, you are not going to have ampersand and asterisk together. Moreover, this is very, very tricky. If you misplace the parentheses or you add one more or less ampersand or asterisk, the consequences can be kind of interesting. So I put this in blue, but maybe it should be red. Be careful when you have in one instruction those two together. What happened with arrays? Because the good news is an array is a pointer. In Java, you remember this idea that you store a reference. In Java, this was a reference, and the reference point to the first element in the array. You review that. You know what? Here, the arrays, every single time that you create an array, you're creating a pointer. Why? Because this guy here is my array A, and my array A have six elements. These are my six elements. Always, always, always. The name is not the name of the array. The name is the name of the pointer that is pointing to the first element. Are you telling me that this is doing int asterisk a? Yes. And hopefully you can imagine that int asterisk asterisk is a bidimensional array. It's going to be connected. And three asterisk is going to be connected with three dimensional arrays and so on. The number of asterisk is like the number of square brackets. But this is going to be the chapter 2. We continue next lecture. Any question?